بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وعلى كل من تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما سبحانك اللهم لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه وبعد. Respected brothers and sisters, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillah. Toronto needs to wake up a bit. You have no difficulty in being awake. You have every corner Tim Hortons. Every time you doze off, there's a Tim Hortons. So there's no excuse for being asleep. Alhamdulillah, we praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's an honor and a privilege for myself to be here once again at this Pearls to Paradise, Off Paradise event, program, conference at Masjid Abu Bakr Siddique radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Remember, this masjid is on the name of Sayyiduna Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. So we should always try to say radiallahu anhu whenever we say the name Abu Bakr Masjid. It's not brother Abu Bakr, it's Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. And we'll get a reward as well, inshallah. It's not sinful if we don't, but inshallah we'll get so much reward. Every time we say, I'm going to Masjid Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, or even Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. I would like to thank the organizers, people who've organized this event, the committee, the imam, people of the locality, for once again arranging this very important program. And the theme, as you've seen with all the lectures which over the 2 days, inshallah, coming back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through various ways. What does that mean, coming back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? I mean, my talk is coming back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through excellence. What I want to do briefly, inshallah, in the few minutes that I have before us, is mention a hadith, which is a famous hadith that we all know about, and explain it, and then talk about some very, very important points in relation to that hadith. There's a famous hadith that you must have heard this hadith many, many times from the imams, and must have read this hadith as well. It's called the hadith of Jibreel, the hadith of Ihsan. The title that I have is coming back to Allah with excellence. Excellence is a word that translates the word Ihsan. But actually, really, if you try to translate the word Ihsan, you can't really translate it. This is probably the closest word that we can use for Ihsan, excellence. The word Ihsan in Arabic is a unique word. It's one of those words, there are few terms and words in Arabic that are impossible to understand properly in any other language, like the word taqwa. Today in the morning workshop, I was explaining that the Arabic language is so deep that, for example, fear. In English, we have one word, fear. Whether you're fearing a donkey or a camel or a lion or a scorpion or a spider or your father or your uncle or the police, it's fear. Whereas in Arabic, different types of fears have been described with different words. There's one fear, a fear before a lion. Different word to describe that fear. There's the fear before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not the fear, a'udhu billahi min dhalik. It's not the fear that we have that before an animal. The fear is of awe, of respect, of love. It's a different type of fear. And that fear is described with taqwa or khashya. We have taqwa, we have khashya, we have hadhar, we have khawf. Different words used for different types of fear. So taqwa is a word as well which is very difficult to describe. Likewise, the word adab in Arabic is a very difficult word to describe. Likewise, the word ihsan, we can say excellence, perfection, goodness, good manners, beautification, beauty, and many other words can be used. But probably the closest of the word, translating the word, is excellence. So this word ihsan has been mentioned in this famous hadith of Jibreel alayhi salam. And it's mentioned in this hadith, known as the hadith of Jibreel, also called the hadith of Ihsan. And I won't go into the details of the hadith, but many of you have heard of this hadith. But because the word is mentioned, and I want to talk about this word and explain it properly, The Messenger, Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, another companion of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he relates this is in Sahih al-Bukhari, Sahih Muslim, and most hadith collections, that we were sat with Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam once when a man entered the masjid. Is طَلَعَ عَلَيْنَا رَجُلْ شَدِيدُ بَيَاضِ الثِّيَابِ. And he had extreme white clothes on him. شَدِيدُ سَوَادِ الشَّعْرِ. And his hair was really dark black. This was, the hadith is all, basically, the theme of the hadith is that it was meant to startle or raise the eyebrows of the companions sat before the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. This was the reason, so that they are all perplexed and a bit astonished and surprised. Everything is a bit surprising, so they take whatever is discussed with this person, they take it seriously. So when this person came, first of all, he had, his clothes were extremely white, shining, shadidu bayadi thiyab, the clothing very white, and the hair was extremely black. This was like a contradiction. It stood out. He stood out. He was a different. We hadn't seen someone like this. And then another issue was, لا يرى عليه أثر السفر ولا يعرفه منا أحد. There was no effect of traveling on him, but nobody knew him. Remember, Medina in those days was a very small community. Everyone knew everybody, like some Gujaratis. They know everyone knows everybody. You know, you come from the airport and they know everywhere where you've been and who's come and who's... They'll know how many suitcases you've brought as well from India and what you've brought with you from the airport. Some people become very nosy, which is also not Islamic. But this is from the hadith. لا تجسسوا لا تحسسوا. This is another topic. It's good to know about people and take care of people, but with a balance. With a balance. Islam is all about i'tidal. So it's good to know your neighborhood, know about people, what are their needs. But then overstepping the boundary and becoming very, very inquisitive and nosy is actually un-Islamic. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in a hadith, لا تجسسوا ولا تحسسوا. Do not become too nosy in the affairs of other people. Sometimes people have this habit, we have this more in the UK, maybe not here, that people are standing outside the masjids and, you know, just looking in corners and who's coming and who's driving and who's doing what and whose wife's going where and whose dad's going where and who's... This is a bit, you know, makes people uncomfortable. So anyway, so that time they all knew one another because it was a very small community. So this person who came, none of us knew who he was. But then, if no one knew him, it must have been someone who came from outside Medina. But there was no effect of traveling. Again, effect of traveling, when in those days when people used to travel, their clothes would be disheveled, they would have dust because they would travel on camels in the desert. They wouldn't just land at Pearson Airport and come from straight from the airport into the masjid here, and you know, the clothes are still ironed. So, لا يرى عليه أثر السفر ولا يَعْرِفُهُ مِنَّا أَحَدٍ. We didn't know him, but then he's not... Is he from Medina? It just seemed like he just came out from across the road. But nobody knows him. So they were all perplexed, the companions. Umar radiallahu anhu relating this, that we were a bit perplexed. And then he came and he started speaking to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, Ya Muhammad. Another surprising statement. Nobody calls him Ya Muhammad. We used to all say, Ya Rasulullah. The Sahaba used to say what? Ya Rasulullah, O Messenger of Allah. Nobody said, Ya Muhammad. And he is saying, Ya Muhammad. So what's wrong with this guy? First of all, he's not from here, but he's not from outside. Now he's saying, Ya Muhammad. Okay, what's going on? And then after that, he said, I'm going to ask you a few questions. And he asked a few questions. First question was, Mal Iman? What is Iman? Tell me what Iman is. So the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replied and he said, أن تؤمن بالله وملائكته وكتبه ورسوله واليوم الآخر والقدر خيره وشره. That you believe in Allah and his messengers and the final day and the books and the angels and qadr, fate, destination, you know, the basic aqaid beliefs of Islam. Then so when the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replied and told him what Iman was, he said, صدقت. Also, sorry, before that, when he sat down, he placed his hands على فخذيه. This he refers to, he places hands on his own thighs or on the thighs of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And many commentators of the hadith are of the opinion that it was on the thighs of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You know how we sit in tashahud in salah? So he sat like that in front of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because there was nothing surprising if you put your own hands on your own thighs. So the more correct opinion is that he placed it on the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam's thighs. You're not going to go and sit next to someone and say, you know, put your hands on their thighs. So this was a bit surprising as well. And then he asked this question. So when the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam replied to him, he said, "Sadaqta, you've spoken the truth." Again, this is a bit perplexing. Does he know or does he not know? If he didn't know, then why is he saying "Sadaqta"? Yeah, you said the truth. And if you already knew, then why is he asking the question? Then he said, "Mal Islam? What is Islam?" The Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam replied, and he said, "You say the Shahada." أن تشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأن محمدا رسول الله وتقيم الصلاة وتؤتي الزكاة وتصوم رمضان صلاة زكاة fasting of Ramadan and Hajj إن استطعت إليه سبيلا. And then the third question, which is the most important question for our talk today, ما الإحسان? What is إحسان? So the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam replied, and every time when he was replying he was saying صدقت, you spoke the truth. He said, what is إحسان? So the Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "An ta'abuda Allah ka annaka tara." Ihsan is that you worship Allah as though you are seeing Him. فَإِنْ لَمْ تَكُنْ تَرَاهُ فَإِنَّهُ يَرَاكُ. And if you can't reach the level that you are seeing Allah, then at least know that Allah is seeing you. He again said, "Sadaqta." And then the hadith concludes. Then he asked about Mata Sa'a, when is the final day? When is the day of judgment? 2012 or 2015 or 2018? When is Qiyamah coming? He said, Mal Mas'ulu A'lamu Anha min As-Sa'il. The one being asked, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying, the one being asked has no more knowledge of when Yawmul Qiyamah will arrive than the one asking. However, I'll tell you some signs. Ukhbiruka an amaratiha. And then he said, An talidal amatu rabbataha. The meaning of that is basically, one of the meanings and the most common meaning is that there'll be disobedience to parents. It's a sign of Qiyamah. And وَأَن تَرَى الْحُفَاتَ الْعُرَاتَ الْعَالَةَ رِعَاءَ الشَّاءِ يَتَطَاوَلُونَ فِي الْبُنْيَانِ. And one of the signs of Qiyamah is that you will see suddenly people who are barefooted, who don't have much clothes, poor people, shepherds in the deserts, suddenly erecting massive buildings in the middle of the desert and competing with another with this burj and that burj. Does it ring a bell? Burj this and burj that. Suddenly, in the middle of nowhere in a desert, these are all shepherds. One day they are shepherds and now they are princes. Driving million-pound, billion-dollar cars. Suddenly just competing. It's all about buildings here. It's all about just properties. It's just about the tallest and the highest skyliners of whichever Sharif we're talking about. And this is one of the signs of Qiyamah. And then the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after that, Umar radiallahu anhu said, he left, when he departed, he said, "Oh Umar, do you know who that was?" This was a suspense, basically, maybe you probably know anyway. Do you know who this was? This was Jibreel. أَتَاكُمْ يُعَلِّمُكُمْ دِينَكُمْ. He came to teach you your religion. That's why he came and he asked these questions. Now, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam could have himself, you know, taught them these things. The question is, why do we need Jibreel to come and teach these things? But this is different ways of teaching. One of the ways of teaching is a scenario is set when someone comes. That's why the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sometimes used to say to the Sahaba, "Shall I not tell you about something? Shall I not tell you? Shall I not tell you? Shall I tell you something which is better than this?" So okay, here, just to bring the attention, there's a whole book written on the topic of being a good teacher. Not just in Islamic studies, but a school teacher, college teacher, university teacher, and a madrasa teacher. Ar-Rasulul Mu'allim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet as a Teacher, written by Shaykh Abdul Fattah Abu Ghudda, rahimahullah. It's actually translated into English as well. It's a very important book. So this was one of the methods of teaching. Now, the point here is ihsan. What is ihsan? It is as though you are seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What does that mean? Turning to Allah, returning to Allah, coming back to Allah through ihsan, through excellence. If you look at this hadith, how many questions did he ask? there was four with the sign of the Qiyamah and when Qiyamah will arrive. But the main three were Iman, Islam, Ihsan, about deen. So which shows Ihsan is one third of religion. Ihsan is, you know, there's approximately 63, how many? 63 verses in the Quran that has a word derived from the word Ihsan. إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الْمُحْسِنِينَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ اتَّقَوْا وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ مُحْسِنُونَ ذَلِكَ خَيْرُ وَأَحْسَنُ تَأْوِيلًا إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُ بِالْعَدْلِ وَالْإِحْسَانِ هَلْ جَزَاءُ الْإِحْسَانِ إِلَّا الْإِحْسَانِ حَقًّا عَلَى الْمُحْسِنِينَ. There's 63. I read this somewhere and then I once counted them myself, and it was actually on a flight from London to Toronto many years ago. I have them all written with my pen because I wrote them all in the plane. 63 verses in the Quran relating to Ihsan. It's a very, very important part of our deen. This is why every Jumu'ah we hear the khutbah, everyone knows this verse, right? Inna Allah ya'muru bil adli wal ihsani. We're already standing up. Don't stand up. Yes, just relax, relax. I know we have to go work. Inna Allah ya'muru bil adli wal ihsani wa ita'i dhil qurba wa yanha 'anil fahsha'i wal munkari wal baghi. When I recite the khutbah, I'll stop at al-baghi. Sabar, sabar. Ya'idhukum la'allakum tadhakkaroon. Udhkurullaha yadhkurkum wad'uuhu yastajib lakum wa ladhikrullahi akbar. Wallahu ya'lamu ma tasna'oon. Then you stand up. So this is the ayah of the Quran. Allah commands adl, justice and ihsan. There's a hadith where Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَتَبَ الْإِحْسَانَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ. Indeed, Allah has prescribed ihsan on everything. So it's a fard. Just like praying five-time prayers and offering them, it's fard. Ihsan is fard. So what is this ihsan that is fard? And it's one-third of religion. And 63 verses talk about ihsan. We said it's excellence. Ihsan is basically in every aspect of our life. The main aspect is ihsan with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But there are verses of the Quran that talk about ihsan with Allah, then ihsan in every field, aspect and sphere of our life. If we look at ihsan with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, excellence with Allah, this hadith, worship Allah as though you are seeing Him, actually is referring to only one aspect of ihsan, which is ihsan with Allah. What does that mean, ihsan with Allah? You know what that means? Do you want to know what that means? Yes? No? Yes. Okay. You heard of the word taqwa. What does taqwa mean? Fear is one of the translations, but not the real translation. Awareness of Allah, which means you realize that Allah is watching you. Ihsan is you are watching Allah. Taqwa is a level. The next level is ihsan. Taqwa is you are being watched. Before a person says anything, does anything, writes anything, makes any gestures, wherever you are. Remember the story where you get told when you were children? The teacher gave sweets to all the small children. Go and eat this sweet somewhere where nobody's watching you. Everybody came, someone under the bed was hiding, someone somewhere. One child came back. I couldn't find any place where I could eat because there was no place that Allah wasn't watching me. So Allah is watching me everywhere. This is the realization of taqwa, God awareness, Allah consciousness, knowing and realizing that Allahu yuraqibuka, Allah is watching over us. That stops us from sinning. But that's first level. The people of a higher level, they go beyond taqwa. They go to the level of ihsan, which is that they are seeing Allah with the heart. You have basara and you have basira. Basara is the sight of the eyes. Basira is the sight of the heart. Basara, basar, which means sight. So sight of the eyes, this is seeing Allah with the sight of the heart. Every aspect of our life, constantly, the people of ihsan, the hadith said, worship Allah as though you are seeing Him. Worship, dua is worship. So when we make dua, not dua like, Ameen. No, you make dua like you are seeing Allah. And the hadith said, if you can't reach that level, then know that Allah is seeing you. That's the taqwa level. So at least let's start off with that. When I'm making dua, Allah is watching me. That will take us to the next level, that when I make dua, I am seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with the sight of the heart. We can't see Allah with the sight of the eyes. لا تدركه الأبصار وهو يدرك الأبصار. It's in the akhirah that we will see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inshaAllah. But in this life, we can't see Allah. We can see Him with the heart. So dua is worship. Any worship is that we carry out, the level of ihsan is making that worship, executing that worship with the understanding that Allah, we are seeing Allah. Dua is a istighfar, everything. And what's the greatest worship? So every worship, hajj as well. When we perform hajj, let's perform hajj with ihsan. At least Allah is watching us. And then the next level, you go to Mina, you see Allah, you are witnessing Allah, you are next to the Kaaba, you are seeing Allah with your heart, you are in Arafah, you are seeing Allah. Fasting with this realization, you eating suhoor, suhoor, and the whole day of fasting till iftar. Fast, worship Allah, and ta'bud Allah. This is not just prayer. And ta'bud Allah, you are worshipping Allah as though you are seeing Him. That's ihsan. Every form of worship, and the greatest form of worship is salah. At least in salah, we should try to get to the level of ihsan. You know, in salah, what is ihsan in salah? I'll explain to you what ihsan in salah is. A lot of people hear the term khushu and khudu. Have you heard of these two terms? Khushu, khudu. Okay, people just say khushu, khudu, khudu. What does it mean? This is not the same. These two words are separate. They're not the same. Khushu' means something else, and khudu' means something else. Khudu' fil zahir wal khushu' fil batin. Khudu' means we offer our salah externally in accordance with the sunnah. Like, not the sunnah, though, because the sunnah of where to raise your hands and place them, there's differences in that. But the more important part is to perform salah with khudu', which means with tamanina, with calmness and composure. Not quick, fast, no rush. I just remembered the first article I actually wrote in my life, and I was, I think, 17 in English. This was when I was studying in Darul Ulum Bury in UK, and our patron and our sheikh down there, Sheikh al-Hadith Murana Yusuf Mutala Rahimahullah, who passed away here recently. I visited his grave as well today. He actually told me to write this. And there used to be a magazine called Subul al-Salam that they had recently started. And I think I was in the fourth year, I can't remember. And the title was, What's the Rush? He goes to me, write something. Start writing. So I just thought, I want to write about praying salah in a calm manner. And the title was, What's the Rush? What's the rush? Khudu' means offering salah in a calm, composed, collective manner. It is wajib, i'tidalul arkan. You know, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, when you offer salah, فَإِذَا طَمَأْنَنْتَ قَائِمًا, when you are calmly, then recite al-Fatiha and surah. فَإِذَا طَمَأْنَنْتَ رَاكِعًا, when you go into ruku', be calm, take your time. Then فَإِذَا طَمَأْنَنْتَ قَائِمًا قَوْمًا, and then when you're in sujood, all of these arkan and integrals of salah, perform them without a rush, in a calm, composed manner. This is called khudu', external application of the sunnah of salah. Then we have another term, which is khushu'. So khudu' is external. Khushu' is the internal aspect of prayer. Internal aspect of prayer, khushu' means awareness and concentration. And there's actually three levels. I'm mentioning these three levels to explain to you what ihsan is. So number one is khudu', number two is khushu'. And then two is divided into A, B, and C. A, B, and C. A, when we offer salah, the first level, A, B, and C. So the first level of khushu' is when a person is offering his salah, he knows at the time of salah that he is offering salah, and at every part of salah he knows what he's doing, or she knows what she's doing. Nowadays, what happens to us? Allahu Akbar, straight to Japan. Assalamu alaikum warahmatullah, Jame Masjid Abu Bakr Siddique radiallahu anhu, I've come back. Now, salah is valid, and I'm not saying it's easy to have full concentration. It's difficult in the beginning, but this is the point. We all have to work. You might start off with 5% awareness and 95% ghafla. Then if we take it as something important, after about a week or two, we might get 7%, 10%. You might go to 20%, then goes to 30%. You might start, okay, today's salah, I am going to focus. I'm going to make sure that I know what I'm saying when I'm reciting. So, okay, Allahu Akbar, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, I am praying salah, I am reading these words, Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim, I am reciting these words, Maliki Yawmiddin, I'm reciting these words. And by the time you get to Iyaka Na'budu wa Iyaka Nasta'in, you're in Tim Hortons. And then, Salat al-Ladina an'amta alayhim, baseball. Ghayr al-Maghdubi alayhim al-Dallin, hockey or something, yeah? And then, oh, no, Salah, what is it? Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Ara'ayta alladhi yukadhibu bid-deen. And then maybe halfway through you've gone somewhere else, then you've come back, off, on, no problem. Start off like that, at least some percentage of awareness that we are offering Salah. And then when you go into ruku', we should know what we are reciting. I am actually saying Subhana Rabbi al-Azim. I am actually saying Sami'a Allahu liman hamida. Rabbana lakal hamd. And in sujood. So this is the first level. This is the basic level of khushu'. We need to get to at least second level. First level, you know why? Because first level is difficult. If we try to get the second level, then the first is easier with the second level. You know what the second level is? The second level is not just knowing what you are saying and reciting and uttering and pronouncing and what you are doing. Rather, you know the meanings of what you are reading. It's basic. You know, we have so much time, brothers and sisters. We read so many magazines, so many newspapers, so much online, so much Amazon, so much eBay. So we have so much time. We just need to take out like just 2 days. Just 2 days. To learn and understand what salah means. I remember a few years ago in the UK, we actually held a course, and which is a good course to have here as well. Awakening the prayer. Awakening the prayer from the beginning, from wudu. So when you're washing your hands, what are you thinking? Why are you washing your hands like this? What is it? So you should know what intention, what meanings should be in the mind. Ihsan basically means being connected to Allah. Not a robotic wudu and not a robotic salah, a human being salah. This is not a button switch on, wudu and salah done. It's a robot. We're not robots before Allah. We should be human beings, abd and slave of Allah. So when we are, and then when I'm gargling, what am I thinking? Then washing the hands, the hadith says all the sins, small minor sins, are forgiven. So when I'm washing my arms, oh, alhamdulillah, all my sins, small sins, not major sins. If you owe someone $2,000, you still have to pay them, yes, after wudu. It doesn't mean that's forgiven. But minor sins here and there, we all have minor sins. Alhamdulillah, Allah is forgiving me, Allah forgive me. And read the du'as as well at the same time. And then another hand, because it's mentioned in the hadith. So wudu with knowing why we're doing that. And then salah, why do we raise our hands? What's the hikmah, what's the purpose, what thought should be in the mind when we raise our hands here or here if the sisters are raising. And after that, when we say Allahu Akbar, knowing the meaning, Allahu Akbar min kulli shay, Allahu Akbar kabira, Allah is greater than everything and anything we can imagine and envisage and think of. And then when we recite Surah Al-Fatiha, at least learn the meanings of Surah Al-Fatiha. This is a surah we recite how many times in our day? Many times. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Seriously, if you offer salah like that, so you pray, you say, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. All praise to Allah for everything I am breathing, I am seeing. Don't start thinking too many things here. Don't start saying, Alhamdulillah. No, I'm not saying that. But just praise to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All the ni'am, bounties, gifts, walking, legs, hands, health, food, pizzas, burgers, water, Tim Hortons. How much ni'am do we have from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. What does Ar-Rahman mean? What does Ar-Rahim mean? What does Malik Yawmiddin? What does it mean? With the thought and meanings in the mind. And then we're making dua to Allah. Ihdina as-sirat al-mustaqim. Sirat al-ladhina an'amta alayhim. Ghayr al-maghdubi alayhim wa radhalin. And then the surah that you are reciting, learn the meanings of the last few surahs of the Quran from surah at least what duha or surah al-fil. The ones that we regularly recite, learn the translations and the meanings of those. قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ اللَّهُ الصَّمَدْ. That's why many ulama have said, in order to get and achieve concentration, the normal ruling, and there's a difference of opinion between the fiqh madhabs, should you close your eyes in prayer or not? So some said, no, you shouldn't close your eyes, but all the madhabs agree that if it's for concentration, if you can't get the concentration except by closing your eyes, then it's okay in the beginning. And then you will reach a level that you will not need to close your eyes in order to achieve the concentration. So if you want to close your eyes in the beginning, do that. You know, recite the surah, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ اللَّهُ الصَّمَدْ لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ. Think of the meanings. And then not just whilst you're standing, whilst we're in ruku'. So we say, Allahu Akbar, I am in ruku'. Subhana Rabbi Al-Azim. It's a massive statement. Subhana Rabbi Al-Azim. Subhana Rabbi Al-Azim or Rabbi Al-Azim, but it's three words. What does that mean? Sami'a Allahu liman hamida. Allah is hearing the one who praises him. Allah, you hear. You are hearing right now. Rabbana lakal hamd. Hamdan kathiran, tayyiban, mubarakan. I am praising you, Allah. You are hearing it. Then Allahu Akbar into sujood. Now sujood, azim has changed into a'la. Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. Because now we're in an adna state. Adna is the lowest state before Allah. So we talk about Allah's ulu and Allah's loftiness, elevation of status and rank. Not position, but status and rank. Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. And then the whole salah. What does at-tahiyyatu mean? At-tahiyyatu lillah. Tahiyyat belongs to Allah. Salawat belongs to Allah. Tayyibat belongs to Allah. As-salamu alayka ayyuhan nabi. Wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. As-salamu alayna wa all of us. Ibadillahi salihin. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. I am bearing witness there is no God but Allah. Wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh. And then say the salawat on the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with the meanings. And then the dua at the end. Any dua, you know, you can make any dua if you know in salah. But it has to be Arabic and it has to be Ad'iya al-Ma'thura from the Quran and Sunnah. You can't start speaking in English, oh Allah, you know what, tomorrow I've got a work job. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. Allah, you know what, tomorrow there's an interview, I need to pass that. No, don't do that. Allahumma inni zalamtu nafsi, Rabbana atina fi dunya, Rabbana hablana min azwajina. Various, you can read 6-7 different du'as. But if you're an imam, don't do that, yes, because you don't want to start reading du'as for 10 minutes and everyone's waiting. They might think that your soul's left. You know, they'll come and say, Imam, what's happened? Are you still alive? So, if you're praying by yourself, you can make lots of different supplications, all of them with meanings. And then, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. What's the niyyah? Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. And then, adhkar ba'd salah. So the whole salah, second level, which is with khushu', knowing the meanings of what we are reciting. How many levels? Two levels. Khudu' was external. Khushu' level one was? Awake? No. First level was knowing what you just, without the meaning, but knowing that you're doing that. Second level is knowing the meaning as well. And the third level is what's mentioned in the hadith. Ihsan. Not just knowing what you're doing, not just knowing the meaning, but أن تعبد الله كأنك تراه. That you are actually seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in your salah. Salat muwaddi'. It's as though it's your last prayer. So the salah is like, you know, we stand before Allah. This is it's a big thing. That's why the Quran says, Inna salata tanha anil fahshai wal munkar. If people offer salah in this way, it will save them from all sins. You will become pure in your mind, in your heart, full of spirituality. Salah is the greatest thing. Imagine, Allahu Akbar. And we know, we realize, okay, I'm before Allah. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. You know, the Salaf, the way they would recite Salah, perform Salah, is like they would shake sometimes. I'm seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every Salah, 5 times before Allah. There's no scratching of the head and there's no playing with a beard and there's none of those stuff. This is Ihsan, offering Salah as though you are seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the third level. So not this is in salah, but like I was saying, ihsan is not just in salah. Ihsan is with even outside of salah. Even outside of salah, there's one companion, Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu. He says, my beloved messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam gave me a nasiha, a wasiya, and he said, fear Allah always outside prayer as well as though you are seeing Him. So outside salah as well, when you walk out, everywhere, try to be in a state that you are seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is something that connects us with Allah. Talk to Allah. Like I said, dua. We should make a habit of talking with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, conversing. There's nothing wrong in conversing with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Dua is a powerful, powerful tool. Silahul mu'min. It's the weapon of a believer. Remember, dua, the adab is, of course, we raise our hands, but it's not necessary to always raise our hands. Dua is something that should be constant in our day-to-day life. Always. Some of the shuyukh say that always keep on asking Allah for something. Always. Like you come out of the masjid, before you get to the parking lot, say, oh Allah, I'm asking you for the goodness of my car, that no one's smashed the window or, you know, the tire's not burst. Oh Allah, you sit in the car. This is why we recite, Subhanalladhi sakhara lana hadha wa ma kunna lahu muqrinin. I want to reach safely home. You park your car before entering the house, putting the key in the door. Oh Allah, I want to see my family in a healthy state. No problems, no nothing, nothing to startle me. Oh Allah, make this easy. Oh Allah, make that easy. Oh Allah, just constantly speaking and talking to Allah. Sometimes in khalwa, talk to Allah, in seclusion. You know, people like to talk. A problem half shared is a problem. What's that saying? Eased or something. You know, people, they say, when you talk to someone about your problems, it makes you feel better. That's why a lot of our sisters, they like to talk about their problems. Instead of talking to the whole world, talk to Allah. Because when you talk to other people, there's a fear that you might get involved in ghibah. There's no ghibah with Allah. Talk to Allah, complain about everyone. You complain about your husband. Oh Allah, my husband, he was doing this and my husband like that. Tell Allah everything about your husband. No problem. There's no ghibah. There's no sin. Talk to Allah. Converse with Allah. Have a conversation. This is ihsan, being always connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And to conclude, I was saying ihsan is in every aspect of life. This was my main part, but also every aspect. This is why the whole of Islam is based on ihsan. So worshipping Allah and connecting with Allah with ihsan. But outside that, if you look, the Quran tells us relationship with others. The famous verse about parents, وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّاهُ وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. Your Lord has decreed, worship none but Him, but and also has decreed that with your parents, treat them with ihsan, which means excellence, in a good state. Ihsan with parents. The Quran tells us that even divorce should be with ihsan. What does that mean? الطَّلَاقُ مَرَّتَان. Talaq is two times. فَإِمْسَاكُمْ بِمَعْرُوفٍ. After two times, now keep hold on to your wife in an honorable way. بِمَعْرُوفٍ. Or, if you're not getting along, then don't worry, it's halal. تَصْرِيح, which means talaq. Or, separate and have a divorce, but with ihsan, in an excellent way. In an amicable manner, like a human being. Not causing problems and fights. Not two families becoming lifelong enemies. Not pointing fingers. And actually the Quran says that at the time of divorce, you should give a small gift. The husband should give a small, the ex-husband or soon to be ex-husband, should give a small parting gift. A lot of people don't know this. Everyone knows about mahar because everyone's happy about mahar. Mahar is, do you know what mahar is? Mahar, the concept of mahar is not that this is your payment of lifetime. This is not what mahar is. Mahar is a welcome pack gift. And the other gift, it's actually called mut'ah. There's another mut'ah, you know, that Shia one, not that. But this is another mut'ah. Mahar and mut'ah. Mahar is a welcome gift. Mut'ah is a bye-bye gift. Goodbye gift. This is what it is. Just like mahar is necessary, it's wajib. And mut'ah is mustahab, recommended. The Quran says, those who give mahar, what is it? Those who give mut'ah, which means that when there's a divorce, the husband goes to the wife, sorry, it didn't work out, we tried our best, It didn't work out. Not your fault, not my fault. Or we're both at fault. Allah forgive you, Allah forgive me. Best of luck for the future. Inshallah, you get a good husband in the future. Best of wishes. She says, yeah, it didn't work out, inshallah. And we'll amicably separate. If there's children involved, no problem. Everything will be like normal human beings. You know, not even just Muslim, we'll be normal human beings. And good luck for the future, forgiveness, forgive me. You know how we go for Hajj, we ask forgiveness. Seek forgiveness from one another. And then the husband says, wait a minute, there's the bag for you here. This is a gift, inshallah. This is called mut'a. The Quran talks about this. This is not in some weak hadith. This is in Quran, in Surah Al-Baqarah. مَتِّعُوهُنَّ عَلَى الْمُوسِعِ قَدَرُهُ وَعَلَى الْمُقْتِرِ قَدَرُهُ. When Allah talks about this, then He said, حَقًّا عَلَى الْمُحْسِنِينَ. The people of Ihsan, they give this gift. The people who don't have Ihsan, they don't give this gift. Give talaq with Ihsan, and then give the gift, you'll be people of Ihsan. So talaq is with Ihsan. Parents, Ihsan. Business and trade, this verse is, I can go into all the different fields. Buying and selling, awful kail, ذَلِكَ خَيْرٌ وَأَحْسَنٌ. When you buy and sell, measurement, be truthful in your business. Don't get engaged in fraud and deception and cheating. And then the Quran says, this is ahsan. This is someone who has ihsan in him. And even slaughtering animals, there's a hadith of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam that says that فَإِذَا قَتَلْتُمْ فَأَحْسِنُوا الْقِتْلَ وَإِذَا ذَبَحْتُمْ فَأَحْسِنُوا الذِّبْحَ وَلْيُحِدَّ أَحَدُكُمْ شَفْرَتَهُ وَلْيُرِحْ ذَبِيحَتَهُ. When one of you slaughters an animal, a cow or a camel or a sheep or whatever you're slaughtering, slaughter as well with ihsan. Don't become jungly human beings that have never seen chicken in their life, that we are just born. Because there's two extremes. You get one extreme, people are vegetarians, they just think eating any animal meat is like bad. But then there are other extremes of meat-eating and, you know, human beings who just think that animals are like, kill them and slaughter them and whatever, and who cares, whatever. Islam says, no, we've allowed you to eat animals, and animals have been created for your benefit, but that doesn't mean you treat them in a bad way, and no malpractice. You know, slaughter them with ihsan. Give them the least pain as possible. This is ihsan with animals. Dealing with non-Muslims. There are verses about dealing with non-Muslims with ihsan. وَجَادِلْهُمْ بِالَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنُ. Converse and debate and argue with ihsan with non-Muslims. Da'wah to Muslims. عُدُوا إِلَى سَبِيلِ رَبِّكَ بِالْحِكْمَةِ وَالْمَوْئِذَةِ الْحَسَنَةِ. Hasana is from the word ihsan. Invite people with ihsan. Even da'wah should be with ihsan. So there's verses about every aspect. And then there are verses, and the last verse I will recite. The last verse, Allah talks about the rewards for ihsan. Allah is with the people of ihsan, and there's so many different rewards. There's verses that talk about those people who have ihsan in their life, whether it's in worship, salah, whether it's in fasting, zakat, hajj, and dua, whether it's with your parents, whether with your children, with your spouse, marriage, divorce, animals, every aspect. When you have ihsan, there are verses that talk about the rewards. One verse is, إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ تَقَوَّ وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ مُحْسِنُونَ. Allah is with the people who fear Allah, and He is with the people of ihsan. But last one verse, and listen to this verse, amazing verse. You must have heard of this verse. I'm sure you have. Allah tells you, if you have ihsan, do you want to know what the reward is for ihsan? Do you want to know what the reward is? It's in the Quran. هَلْ جَزَاءُ الْإِحْسَانِ إِلَّا الْإِحْسَانِ. The reward for ihsan is nothing but ihsan from Allah. Amazing. If we have ihsan in our life, the reward from Allah is He will treat us with ihsan. This is in which surah? Surah Al-Rahman. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us the people of ihsan in our worship, in our salah, in our dua, and in our dealings and every aspect of our life. Jazakumullahu khair. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.